الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على النبي الأمي برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين الحمد لله May Allah give us tawfiq to learn more about the Sahaba رضي الله عنه because really shining stars are the Sahaba رضي الله عنه without them the entire deen would not have reached us they preserved protected the deen at the cost of their own lives their families their children what they looked at and what they aspired for was that work and that responsibility that was on the shoulders of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he presented this responsibility of the preservation of deen and the spread of deen and the protection of deen Allah's Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam placed this responsibility on the shoulders of none other than the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum so certainly without them what would our condition be Every day we should study their lives. Study more. Practice their lives. Learn their lives. Emulate them. Remember them. And make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us and forgive us through them. The Sahabi that we learn about was one of those who got that noor of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even though he came to meet Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Aamul Wufud. It was the last years of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this celestial world but Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam's nigah the gaze of Habib sallallahu alaihi wasallam changed individuals it was the 9th year and this year was known as Amul Wufud where delegation after delegation people would come to Medina Munawwara to recite the kalima to meet Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to get their questions answered and they would spend time in the environment of Masjid Nabawi sallallahu alaihi wasallam And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam's efforts and invitations, they embraced Islam. This one tribe came known as Wufd Bani Tamim. Now there's so many tribes, they are known as Wufud, honorable delegations. That's why Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, amongst his last advisors, we all know the advice Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam highlighted and emphasized as he was leaving this world was that do not neglect salah as-salah 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 the importance of salah and the importance of our subordinates respecting and fulfilling the rights of slaves and all those who we have authority over Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam emphasized this and we always get this reminder Allah give us tawfiq to fulfill the haqq of salah and those who Allah has put under our responsibility and care Another advice Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave the ummah wa ajizul wafd bimithli ma kuntu ujizuhum and welcome and treat well the delegations the people coming to embrace Islam welcome them treat them well teach them take care of them assist them support them like you saw me doing oh my ummah this is Habibullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's advice My respected lovers of Sahaba radiyallahu anhum. And this is what Sahaba radiyallahu anhum did after Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam also. How lovingly would they treat the newcomers? How lovingly would they treat their students? Smilingly, lovingly, giving of themselves, giving of their time, serving humanity, helping humanity. Radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. Among these delegations was Wafd Bani Tamim. And when they came, obviously they came from an area that was in the wilderness. Sometimes the natures of people were sometimes coarse. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam educated them, made their tarbiyah, made their reformation, guided them, made their tazkiyah. And how he tolerated them. And on occasions, verses of Quran would be revealed, guiding the ummah. To show respect to Habibullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this delegation actually come to the door of Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was in his home. And what did they say? Oh Muhammad, come out to us! Oh Muhammad, come out to us! And when Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam then came out, then in the discussion they said something to this effect, where they said, Oh Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, afterwards they learned to say Ya Rasulullah and speak to Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam with so much respect. But when people came new, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught the Sahaba how to treat them lovingly and teach them. Like we learn in that environment where people were taught so lovingly by Habibullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They then said, Oh Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, come out quickly because if we praise you, inna madhana zain wa inna dhammana shain. If we praise you, then it will be an upliftment to you for the rest of your life. You would be honored and you would be beautified just by our words in your praise and in your favor. So many of them were poets as well. And then they said, but if we disgrace you and we defame you and we pick on your faults, then it will be disgrace for you forever and ever. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to them and he explained to them that let me clarify one thing. Honor, respect is in the hands of Allah and disgrace is in the hands of Allah. This is the lesson Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave this delegation. He taught them this. And afterwards, verses of Quran also came on this occasion, Surah Al-Hujurat. Really, this is a chapter. And this chapter is also named after the blessed Mubarak homes of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the homes of Ummahatul Mu'mineen, the quarters of Ummahatul Mu'mineen. And in this chapter, Allah Ta'ala highlights the respect us as an ummah owe to the beloved of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And ulama explain here that the respect of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is so imperative that Allah Ta'ala mentions in this chapter that disrespecting Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would nullify one's deeds and actions, meaning would nullify one's iman also. Allah Ta'ala save us. On this occasion, this verse was revealed in Surah Al-Hujurat. Let's study this chapter of the Quran. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُنَادُونَكَ مِنْ وَرَاءِ الْحُجُرَاتِ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. Those who are calling you like that, O Nabi of Allah, from outside your homes, and they're calling you to come out quickly, they have no aql at all, they have no intelligence. So Quran is teaching the whole of humanity to show respect to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ صَبَرُوا حَتَّى تَخْرُجَ إِلَيْهِمْ لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ. If they were to bear patiently, wait outside for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam patiently, that is better for them. And Allah Ta'ala says, وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah is oft forgiving and most merciful. Meaning, this was done certainly unintentional, and afterwards they learn from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam the respect and so forth. So sometimes a person is disrespectful. This is the mercy of Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala gives a person the opportunity to learn. But what Allah dislikes is where a person shows disrespect intentionally. Like there was one Sahabi who naturally had a loud voice. And his name was Thabit bin Qais bin Shammas, even though he's not the Sahabi we're discussing today. And he got so worried when this verse of the Quran was revealed. He actually went in his home and sealed his door in worry that I am ruined, I am ruined. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after a few days, looked for him. Where is the Sahabi of mine? Because he was known as the Khatib of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And afterwards, he was found and Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was explained the situation. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called for him and said, no, you do not do it intentionally. So this was how Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam educated them. Amongst these delegations, there was this Banu Tamim, and amongst them was a Sahabi by the name of Al Qa'qa. There's few Sahaba by this name, but this Sahabi specifically, he is Al Qa'qa ibn Amr al Tamimi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who was there with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was so touched by the environment of Medina Munawwara. He didn't go home. He stayed in Medina Munawwara, learning deen, where historians mention that even when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left this transitory world, he was there, staying by the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, learning the deen of Allah Ta'ala. He was known as a great warrior, a very, very brave man at that time, in his locality, in his area. Even when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw him, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him a question. And what is your name? He said, Al-Qa'qa ibn Amr. Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, Ma a'adatta lil jihad fi sabilillah ya Qa'qa. What did you prepare for striving in the way of Allah, in the cause of Allah, O Qa'qa? He said, I am preparing, and I've prepared ta'at Allah wa rasulihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The obedience of Allah and his rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. First, to obey whatever Allah wants, and whatever my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants. Wal khayl as-safinat, and subservient, obedient horses. Meaning I'm ready to use whatever Allah has afforded me, whatever is available to me, I'm preparing that to use it for the deen of Allah
And he mentioned, even my spears and everything I will use for the deen of Allah. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you have prepared the obedience of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and your resources for the deen of Allah, that is our goal and objective. تِلْكَ الْغَايَةِ. And from that day onward, Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu laid down everything he had, all his resources, all his abilities, all his intellect for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Occasion this verse was revealed in Surah Al-Hujurat. Let's study this chapter of the Quran. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُنَادُونَكَ مِنْ وَرَاءِ الْحُجُرَاتِ أَكْثَرُهُمْ لَا يَعْقِلُونَ. Those who are calling you like that, O Nabi of Allah, from outside your homes, and they're calling you to come out quickly, they have no aql at all, they have no intelligence. So Quran is teaching the whole of humanity to show respect to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah Ta'ala says, وَلَوْ أَنَّهُمْ صَبَرُوا حَتَّى تَخْرُجَ إِلَيْهِمْ لَكَانَ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ. If they were to bear patiently, wait outside for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam patiently, that is better for them. Then Allah Ta'ala says, وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Allah is oft forgiving and most merciful. Meaning, this was done certainly unintentional, and afterwards they learn from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the respect and so forth. So sometimes a person is disrespectful. This is the mercy of Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala gives a person the opportunity to learn. But what Allah dislikes is where a person shows disrespect intentionally. Like there was one Sahabi who naturally had a loud voice. And his name was Thabit bin Qais bin Shammas, even though he's not the Sahabi we're discussing today. And he got so worried when this verse of the Quran was revealed. He actually went in his home and sealed his door in worry that I am ruined. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after a few days, looked for him. Where is the Sahabi of mine? Because he was known as the Khatib of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And afterwards, he was found, and Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was explained the situation. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called for him and said, no, you do not do it intentionally. So this was how Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam educated them. Amongst these delegations, there was this Banu Tamim, and amongst them was a Sahabi by the name of Al Qa'qa. There's few Sahaba by this name, but this Sahabi specifically, he is Al Qa'qa ibn Amr al Tamimi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who was there with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was so touched by the environment of Medina Munawwara. He didn't go home. He stayed in Medina Munawwara, learning deen, where historians mention that even when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left this transitory world, he was there, staying by the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, learning the deen of Allah Ta'ala. He was known as a great warrior, a very, very brave man at that time, in his locality, in his area. Even when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw him, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him a question. That what is your name? He said, Al-Qa'qa ibn Amr. Allah's Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, Ma a'adatta lil jihad fi sabilillah ya Qa'qa. What did you prepare for striving in the way of Allah, in the cause of Allah, O Qa'qa? He said, I am preparing, and I have prepared ta'at Allah wa rasulihi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The obedience of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. First, to obey whatever Allah wants, and whatever my Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wants. Wal khayl as-safinat, and subservient, obedient horses. Meaning I'm ready to use whatever Allah has afforded me, whatever is available to me, I'm preparing that to use it for the deen of Allah. And he mentioned, even my spears and everything I will use for the deen of Allah. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when you have prepared the obedience of Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and your resources for the deen of Allah, that is our goal and objective. تِلْكَ الْغَايَةِ. And from that day onward, Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu laid down everything he had, all his resources, all his abilities, all his intellect for the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another point to share in regards to Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu is certain people deny his existence. And this is actually intentional of them, because they try and attack a reporter who narrates the life of Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu. This reporter is Saif ibn Umar. Now according to the scholars of the sciences of the narrators of hadith, like Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar rahimahullah, Hafidh rahimahullah says, in the science of tarikh, in history. Saif bin Umar is umdatun fi tarikh. He is a very strong narrator and he is reputable and his reports are accepted. Now those who attack Saif ibn Umar are actually attacking him because he narrates the reports about Al-Qa'qa radiyallahu anhu and most of the reports of Abdullah bin Sabah. Abdullah bin Sabah, who caused great trouble, as far as especially in regards to disrespecting and defaming the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, and in his time rallying people to harm Uthman radiyallahu anhu. The narrator of his reports is also Saif ibn Umar. So they try and attack Saif ibn Umar. That's why they negate the existence of Al-Qa'qa radiyallahu anhu, because they actually want to negate the existence of Abdullah bin Sabah. So he remained in Medina Munawwarah, and when Khalid radiyallahu anhu was out in Allah's way during the Khilafah of Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu to bring the Murtaddeen back to Islam, to make effort on the different people of the different areas, explaining to them, connecting them to deen again and fighting the apostates, Khalid radiyallahu anhu fulfilled great tasks, and when he completed his task, he waited in that area where he was in, writing a letter to Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu, waiting for the next instructions. What's the next move? Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu sent the message to Khalid radiyallahu anhu that depart and go to Persia and go help Al-Muthanna ibn Haritha al-Shaybani radiyallahu anhu. Now Khalid radiyallahu anhu departs. Look at the figure. Look at the sacrifice of Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu anhu, Saifullah. He fulfills such a task, bringing the Murtaddeen back to Islam, solving the problem of those who fought against the deen of Allah and stood up against the deen of Allah. And so much of work he already accomplished, he didn't return after that. He was ready to serve deen even more. And now he departs towards Persia. But he writes a letter to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu requesting reinforcements. Now, most of the Sahaba were out in the path of Allah already. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was preparing his men, and now he had one man by his side who Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu trained, and he sends him as a reinforcement to Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu. Those around Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu asked him, "Oh Amir al-Mu'mineen, are you sending one man to help an entire army? Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, أتمد قائدا إن فضى عنه أكثر جنده برجل واحد؟" Khalid radiallahu anhu's army, most of his men have returned. Are you giving him reinforcements in the form of one man? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, "Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed." And then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said certain words that I will share with you just now. When this one individual departs from Medina Munawwara, he goes in the direction of Persia. He meets Khalid radiallahu anhu on the way. And when he arrives, Khalid radiallahu anhu welcomes him, not knowing him so well, not having a personal relationship with him, but he asks him, "Are you here to inform me that the madad, our support, our reinforcements are on the way?" He handed over the letter and he was shocked to see that this man was the madad. The reinforcements came from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu in the form of one individual. Khalid radiallahu anhu was perplexed, but being happy with his Amir, with the Khalifa of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he knew that there is wisdom in this from Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Because Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said to those around him when he was questioned, فَإِنَّ صَوْتَ الْقَعْقَاعَ فَإِنَّ صَوْتَ الْقَعْقَاعِ إِبْنِ عَمْرٍ فِي الْجَيْشِ لَخَيْرٌ مِّنْ أَلْفِ فَارِسٍ. This man's voice in the army is more powerful than 1,000 soldiers. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu then said, he backed up that statement when he said, وَإِنَّهُ لَا يُهْزَمُ جَيْشٌ فِيهِ الْقَعْقَاعِ. If Qa'qa' is amongst my men, they would never be defeated. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu probed the reality of this individual, the Sahabi of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he saw the capability of this man. And that's when he sent him in the path of Allah with Khalid radiallahu anhu. And now they traveled together. He was with the army of Khalid radiallahu anhu. Another letter was sent to Al-Muthanna ibn Haritha al-Shaybani in Persia, who was striving in Allah's way, who was spreading the deen of Allah, who was uplifting the deen of Allah in these far off lands. The letter he received said,
that when Khalid comes, he's a senior Sahabi of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he will be the commander. You will be under him. And when I send him afterwards for some other tasks, you will then regain your position as Amir. And the letter of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to Khalid radiallahu anhu was also in this manner, that you will be the commander, O Khalid, but consider al-Muthanna and appreciate his sacrifices, take his opinions, take mashura from him, and look at the love that Sahaba radiallahu anhu have. Look at the wisdom of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He writes to the one to respect the other, and he writes to the other to respect the one. So like that, we learn Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu's wisdom. Allah give us tawfiq. Certainly we should appreciate each other. Look in the good of others. Respect others. Don't search for each other's faults. Who doesn't have faults? Allah says to Musa alayhi salam, O my Nabi, teach the people that if you look for your own faults, where's the time to look for the faults of others? As they arrive, and now it's time for the first combat. Obviously the Sahaba welcome each other, meet each other. They show each other where's the camp and what's the procedures. Khalid radiallahu anhu receives a rundown from Al-Muthanna radiallahu anhu. And now as they arrived, the first encounter was against a man by the name of Hurmuz. The helmet or the headgear of Hurmuz was valued at 100,000 gold coins. Now the Persians showed their value through showed their position through the value of the headgear, and he was one of the high-ranking men under the king of Persia. The Arabs hated Hurmuz because he was known for ill-treating the Arabs. It was a famous statement and slogan or statement saying of the Arabs: "Ashar min Hurmuz wa akfar min Hurmuz." Much worse than Hurmuz. If someone was very bad or was the worst, they would say even worse than Hurmuz. Or if someone was one who disbelieved and who denied, they would say akfar min Hurmuz. Anyway, as the Sahaba radiallahu anhum camped, Khalid radiallahu anhu wrote a letter to Hurmuz inviting him to Islam, inviting him to the deen of Allah and so forth. And then he said, if you do not remember, my men love dying for Allah's deen like y'all love living in this worldly life. Hurmuz was touched by the letter of Khalid radiallahu anhu. Anyway, he took his men, they camped at a certain place called Hafir. Khalid radiallahu anhu camped at a certain region, Hurmuz at the other. The Sahaba asked Khalid, let's go nearer to the water. He says, remain here, there's wisdom in this, and we'll fight, and we'll conquer, and we'll reach the water. As the two armies camped facing each other, Hurmuz knew if he defeats Khalid radiallahu anhu, he now did and he has fulfilled most of the battle. He felt that without Khalid, the Muslims cannot continue. But he doesn't realize that every mu'min strives for Allah's deen in the same way as Khalid radiallahu anhu. But this was what he felt. So he planned a combat duel. What was the system in warfare? Was when there is duel, you only allowed the same number of men on either side. Either whether it be three on either side, or two on either side, or one on either side. One is not allowed to have more on the one side and lesser on the other side. What Hurmuz did was, he had planned and positioned certain of his men to wait for Khalid radiallahu anhu. And as Khalid comes forward, they were commanded, they were told to await the instruction of Hurmuz to then terminate Khalid radiallahu anhu. So Hurmuz then comes forward, situating himself closer to the Persian army, much more distanced from the Muslim men, to pull Khalid closer to his men. And as Khalid radiallahu anhu comes forward, and him and Hurmuz go into this duel, and as Khalid radiallahu anhu now defeats Hurmuz and drops him on the ground, this other group of men come forward to grab Khalid radiallahu anhu whilst he was busy with Hurmuz. And this was something illegal in warfare. And Khalid radiallahu anhu's life was about to end. But there was one man who realized and who sensed the intentions of Hurmuz. He watched the entire scene. He noticed their maneuver. He comes forward and rescues Khalid radiallahu anhu. He comes in. He pounces on that group of Persians. And he says to them, لَقَدْ جَاءَكَ الْقَعْقَاعُ لَقَدْ جَاءَكَ الْقَعْقَاعُ. Now Qa'qa' has come for you. Qa'qa' has come for you. He pounces on them and he finishes them in a moment. He allows Khalid radiallahu anhu to finish off Hormuz. He finishes off that group who tried to attack Khalid radiallahu anhu from behind his back. And they succeeded, but Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu helped him. Then the battle started, but obviously the Persians were then demoralized because they realized how strong and wise were the Muslims. After that battle was complete, Khalid radiallahu anhu admired Al-Qa'qa ibn Amr and he said, "Lillahi darru Abi Bakrin." To Allah belongs the wisdom. To Allah belongs the wisdom of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. This is a beautiful phrase in the Arabic language. Darrun means pearl, a beautiful, valuable pearl. But it refers to the wisdom of an individual. If someone says or accomplishes or fulfills something marvelous or a great achievement, one is told, "Lillahi darruk." Your pearl, meaning your achievement, is due to Allah. So he says, how wise is Abu Bakr? It means Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is so wise. فَإِنَّهُ أَعْرَفُ مِنَّا بِالرِّجَالِ. He knows his men much more than us. How true is what Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said that Qa'qa will rescue my men. And this is exactly what happened. It was Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu who read this entire maneuver and he rescued the life of Khalid ibn al-Walid radiallahu anhu. Khalid radiallahu anhu realizes the status and the capability of Al-Qa'qa and he keeps him as his right-hand man. And wherever Khalid radiallahu anhu went, he kept Al-Qa'qa by his side. This was in Persia. And all the expeditions in Persia, Khalid radiallahu anhu defeated and Islam spread far and wide. And when the instruction came for Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, from Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, instructing Khalid radiallahu anhu to go to Sham, to go to Syria, the Roman territories, to help the senior Sahaba that were there, Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah, Yazid bin Abi Sufyan, Amr bin As, Shurahbil bin Hasana, radiallahu anhum. These were four commanders. And they had each had their men. Khalid radiallahu anhu was instructed to leave Muthanna radiallahu anhu in charge of Persia. And he should depart with his men. So the 18,000 between Khalid and Muthanna were distributed. And Khalid radiallahu anhu insisted that Al-Qa'qa be by his side. And he went. And alhamdulillah, the Muslims defeated in this famous battle known as Yarmouk. And alhamdulillah, just like the severe battles of Persia was this expedition of Yarmouk. And from Yarmouk, the Muslims went to defeat, went to Damascus. And the history of what happened in Damascus was so amazing. The Muslims sieged that fortress for over 4 months. And how Khalid radiallahu anhu had Al-Qa'qa by his side. When they together climbed this lofty walls of the fortress of Damascus. And the two of them together stealthily went inside. Defeated the garrisons themselves. And opened the door from inside. Screaming out the takbir. And then the Muslims gushed in from the outside. And alhamdulillah, through the efforts of Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu and Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu, the Muslims conquered and defeated and brought down the fortress of Damascus. Something else to take note of is to learn from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum that they were not there for position, they were not there for status, they were not there for the praise of people, they were there only and only for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Khalid radiallahu anhu, he was the commander of the entire army during the battle of Yarmouk. And after Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu left this transitory world, Umar radiallahu anhu became Amirul Mu'mineen. And Umar radiallahu anhu's wisdom was also, you know, he had his amazing strategy and he had his manner. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu felt that Khalid radiallahu anhu should be the commander of the entire armies. Umar radiallahu anhu's opinion was that people feel that we are conquering and defeating and our achievements are so much that is only due to Khalid radiallahu anhu. So he doesn't want people to actually rely on Khalid, but he wanted humanity to turn their gaze to Allah alone. So his first instruction was to appoint Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah as the commander of the entire armies. That means Khalid radiallahu anhu was deposed of his position. So yes, he's no more the commander of all the armies, but he's still a soldier of Allah. And this is how Khalid radiallahu anhu looked at it. And this is how Al Qa'qa bin Amr radiallahu anhu looked at it. Look at Sahaba radiallahu anhu. They knew that they're doing for Allah. Whether they have the position, with the position or without the position, they still serve Allah. They're not serving their desires or their position or fame. They're serving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And now Khalid radiallahu anhu held a high position. But this was the wisdom of Umar radiallahu anhu. He felt Khalid radiallahu anhu is so brave that others cannot catch up with him. Here, he will hold a high position, but under Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah. So whatever he does would be via the Sahabi who Umar radiallahu anhu felt was more reserved and more resolved and more wise because of him being one of the greatest Sahaba, Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah radiallahu anhu. This was the regard of Umar radiallahu anhu for Abu Ubaidah to such an extent that Umar radiallahu anhu said, if Abu Ubaidah was still around and I'm leaving this world, I would have appointed him. Umar radiallahu anhu asked those around him, wish for something. And different people wished for different achievements. That I wish I had so much of wealth to spend it all in the path of Allah. I wish I had such a longer life to spend it all for Allah's sake and for Allah's pleasure, for Allah's deen. Umar radiallahu anhu said, I wish I had an entire structure filled with men just like Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah to serve humanity and serve deen and lead the affairs of the Muslims. This was the regard Umar radiallahu anhu had for Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah. So there was no ulterior motive for Umar radiallahu anhu removing Khalid radiallahu anhu from his high position. Because Umar radiallahu anhu felt that he's still holding a high position, but just under Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah radiallahu anhu. Alhamdulillah, the Muslims were victorious in Sham, at that time Roman territories, and afterwards Islam prevailed there. The non-Muslims lived under Muslims. And the senior Sahaba, they served the deen, teaching the deen of Allah. Then Umar radiallahu anhu would send more Sahaba to those regions to teach the deen of Allah. Amr ibn al-As radiallahu anhu then took Islam into Egypt. And from Egypt himself and his nephew Uqba bin Nafi' radiallahu anhu took Islam into Africa. And that continued in the time of Uthman radiallahu anhu, under the leadership of Abdullah bin Sa'ad bin Abi Sarh radiallahu anhu, taking Islam further into Africa. But here now, Umar radiallahu anhu's instructions arrive in Sham to Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah radiallahu anhu, that those Sahaba who came from Iran at that time, Syria, that came from Persia, return them to Persia. Those that came under Khalid radiallahu anhu, send them back to help Sa'ad bin Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu. So Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah prepared the men. He appointed Hashim bin Utba bin Abi Waqqas radiallahu anhu in charge. And Qa'qa radiallahu anhu was made in charge of the vanguard. And together they depart. They made Mashura. And Al-Qa'qa sought permission from the commander Hashim to allow him to increase in speed to arrive as soon as possible. Because the Muslims in Persia need their help before the battle commences, because the Persians were numbering 240,000 approximately, and the Muslims were approximately but 30,000. Permission was granted to Al-Qa'qa, and he charged with his men, traveling day and night, trying hard to arrive. By the time they had arrived, the Muslims on this side had already commenced, where on the first day a lot of challenges were suffered by the Muslims in the battle of Qadisiyah. Obviously, we learned before how Sa'ad radiallahu anhu invited them to Islam, how the initial commencement of the battle took place, how the takbirs of Sa'ad radiallahu anhu took place, how the initial happening of the battle started. First day is known in history as Yom Armath. It took place in the 13th of Sha'ban, 15th year Hijri. Sa'ad radiallahu anhu gave them amazing advices, and he was very ill at the time, but still strove in Allah's way, watching the entire battle, giving guidelines, being part and parcel of everyone's efforts. The great sacrifice of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Study the advices that Khansa radiallahu anha, great Sahabiya, the advices she presented to her four sons to sacrifice for Allah's deen, and reminding them that this is why she bore them and she prepared them to serve the deen of Allah Ta'ala, and that is success. As that day went by, Muslims incurred a lot of losses. That night, they turned to Allah, they made dua, there was worry. But Allah made it happen as the Muslims spent that night. That night, Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu, with his 1,000 men arrived. They camped far away from the Muslims, awaiting the arrival of dawn. Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu utilized an amazing strategy, saying to his men that we would break ourselves into 10 groups of 100 each. And as the sun rises, and as the Muslims and the people of the Iranians take their lines facing each other, and as the battle is about to be to commence, we would then charge in, our troops would charge in one after the other, making us into 100 troops. But as one troop departs, the next troop would only depart once the first troop is as far as the eye can see. And as we gallop along, we should arouse lots of dust to make us seem much more than we really are. Because we know, respected lovers of Sahaba radiallahu anhum, in comparison to the numbers of the Persians, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum were but few. So this gave lots of himmat to the Muslims, alhamdulillah. And as they all arrived, they took their lines, they also took joined in the rows, and something amazing happened. About to start, so Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu rushed forward. يَطْلُبُ الْمُبَارَزَةِ He sought a challenge in combat. And this was one of the rules of battle, where any party has the right to come forward and seek a duel. And the rules here are that the same number from either side should challenge each other. This was part and parcel of the rules. So as Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu screamed forth, Allahu Akbar, a man from the other side comes forward, challenging Al-Qa'qa, using very, very insultive words towards Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu, saying things like, I'm the most powerful. The whole world stands in awe of me. Look at my pomp and my authority and my experience and my magnificence and grandeur. I will destroy you today. I would devour you people. You would come to the edge of my sword. You will now face me. And he starts laughing loudly. And then he says, go young lad, you're too young. Rather go live your life. Because if you fight me, you will lose your life now. And then Al-Qa'qa asks him, who are you? He says, Bahman, Bahman Jadawi. And this brings lots of joy to the heart of Al-Qa'qa. Because he remembers his companion, his friend, Abu Ubaid radiallahu anhu. We've discussed some time ago in this series the life of Al-Muthanna radiallahu anhu, wherein we discussed Abu Ubaid radiallahu anhu's sacrifice in the Battle of the Bridge, where the Persians challenged the Muslims and then asked the Muslims whether they would like to cross the bridge. And as the Muslims were crossing the bridge to reach the battlefield, the Persians were treacherous in that, attacking the Muslims before completely arriving on the other side. So they portrayed lots of treachery. And that army was led by Bahman Jahdawi. So Al-Qa'qa radiallahu anhu screams out, oh Allah, you gave me the opportunity to avenge the blood of my brother, Abu Ubaid radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And the others give him himmat, yes, Al-Qa'qa, do it for Abu Ubaid. And yes, they did it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to help each other for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Respected listeners, we will continue with this discussion, but let's remember, Allah ta'ala knows best the conditions that humanity is going through at the moment. Alhamdulillah, masajid are opened. Let us return to the masajid. Let us do what is right. Let us please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us not let the masajid be empty. Yes, we should be cautious. And let it not be that our intention of not returning to the masjid is not ulterior. It's not that we are lazy. It's not that we now actually not returning because of the cold and using this condition as an excuse. Allah knows our intentions. We have to return to the order of Allah. We have to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let us make tawbah.
to return, to make effort for Allah Ta'ala's deed. Yes, our reasons for not going to the masjid have to be really proper. Otherwise, having ulterior motives, saying something and thinking something else in our hearts, Allah knows our intentions. Just remember the ahadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that wherein he said, I would like to instruct the men to perform the salah in the masjid, and I go to those homes of those who perform salah at home and let light their homes ablaze. Now remember something, respected listeners. Yes, during the times of lockdown, we had that excuse. Now the bazaars are opened, the marketplaces are opened. Alhamdulillah, our masajid are opened. Let us return to the masajid more. Yes, let's take precaution, but let us not make excuses. Like we don't make excuses when we're fulfilling our need. Remember, our deen and our iman is our most pertinent need. Let's return to the masajid, return to our efforts of iman, our a'mal. Let's strive for Allah's deen. Sahaba radiallahu anhum gave their lives for the deen of Allah Ta'ala. We sacrificing everything, even the deen, just for our lives. Allah's deen comes first. Yes, we have to take caution, because that's also a teaching of the deen of Allah Ta'ala. Allah has allowed us that. But let us not be unwise by following our lusts and desires. Deen is to follow the order of Allah shown by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and not to make our desires our deities. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyil ummi bi rahmatika ya arhamar rahimin.